Hi, my name's Leon Rowe, currency trader and trading coach at trading180.com, and welcome to this week's supply and demand for forex and gold fundamental and technical analysis for the week ahead, starting the 4th of September. And for those of you who regularly check back, apologies for last week. I had to skip the video as last week was a bank holiday in the UK and I thought I'd take a bit of a break, but I'm back for the week, so lots of catching up to do. And yeah, let's get into it. So the 4th of September, it says it's from tradingeconomics.com, and it will be a relatively light week in the United States with the spotlight on ISM services, PMI, factory orders and foreign trade data. Elsewhere, Australia and Canada will announce interest rate decisions. That's going to be important. They're both really kind of expected to hold rates, in fact, especially Canada after their recent data on Friday. GDP growth figures will be released for Australia and Switzerland. Additionally, services PMI reading for China will be assessed for more risk off sentiment. And if you are in the Trading 180 mentoring group, if you go to the Trading Videos channel in the Discord group, then I have uploaded in-depth fundamentals, the weekly ones that I normally do for the private members, as well as the technicals. And if you've missed any of the videos for the week, for example, I've got CPR setup feedback, I've got Euro Yen Stop Hunt and Aussie Yen Stop Hunt breakdowns, group call that we had on Wednesday, a live group call that's an hour and 15 minutes, etc. So lots of videos to catch up on the week if you haven't done so already. So let's get into the technicals and more some fundamentals for the week, and starting off on, in fact, really the dollar index, not the euro dollar. So dollar index is just a measure of dollar strength against the basket of currencies like the euro, the yen and the pound. And on Friday, we had a jobs report come out, and they basically report signals smooth downshift in labor market. So still solid hiring, slower wage growth gives Fed room to pause. And so it was a bit of a mixed day at first. I think the jobs report came out first, and unemployment actually non-farms came out, and employment rose, and so did unemployment at the same time, as well as wage growth. So it's a bit of a mixed one, and I'll read it here anyway. It says the latest US jobs data showed the labor market undergoing a controlled cooling, illustrated by solid hiring, slower earnings growth and more people returning to the workforce. Employers in August added 187,000 jobs in a broad-based advance following downward revisions to payroll in the prior 2 months. Government figures showed Friday hundreds of thousands more joined the labor force, though a growing number was unable to find work right away. And it says here, combined with wage growth running at the lowest pace since early last year, the data illustrate why Americans are a little less upbeat about the jobs market. While hiring and incomes are still firm enough to bolster consumer spending, jobs opening and retreated and layoffs are picking up. So what does that all mean? And it says that the moderation gives the Federal Reserve room to pause interest rate increases this month while keeping options open for another hike later in the year. Traders continue to see the Fed holding steady in September. So the Fed hikes are pretty much the probability of a hold is pretty much priced in now. No change, 94%, 6% chance of a hike, because inflation PCE data did come out, I think it was Thursday, and it did come out a bit lower. Wage inflation came out lower, unemployment came out higher, but also as well, employment FOMC came out higher. So things are moving in the right direction for the Federal Reserve, but it doesn't necessarily mean that the dollar is an all-out sell. And one of the reasons why was because you had the US factory activity gauge suggested stabilization at weak level. So ISM index rose to a 6 month high of 47.6 in August. And so the manufacturing, the purchasing manufacturing index, which is a measure, an indication of used for GDP and an output. In fact, although it's in the contraction phase, we had the data come out actually, and it seems like it's bottoming out. So if it was continuing to go into the contraction mode, we would have, or data, we would have had probably the dollar sell off, because there would have been fears of a more of a hard landing. But we've actually got contraction, you know, bottoming out here. So that actually ended up being positive for the dollar. And what we saw for the dollar at around about 3 o'clock, when that ISM data did come out. So initially, the initial sell-off was due to unemployment figures going higher and wages going lower, and the probability that the Federal Reserve are likely to hold rates. But then when you had ISM come out, and it wasn't as bad as expected, in fact, it was better than expected, you had dollar appreciation. And because, and I've been saying this to the group, the private mentoring group, for a while, we're going to experience a shift in the narrative in terms of whether currencies are driven by interest rates or more to do with the economy. And so if the economy that is going to, and the country that's going to avoid a recession, is going to be the one that you really want to look to buy, because there are other countries out there, like, for example, Europe, and we'll get to Europe in a little bit, and they have a lot of economic worries. And so what's happening is that the narrative is shifting from interest rates, as all central banks are pretty much coming to an end of their interest rate hiking cycle, to who is going to be cutting first based off of an impending recession or a continued contraction. And so that's pretty much what was the reason why you had the dollar actually go appreciate the last maybe, you know, couple of hours, few hours of the day. And so again, although yes, we are seeing a rate hold, again, there is the possibility of also a rate hike as well. If we go to November, and you can see it, in fact, there's still a 33% chance of a, or 35% chance of a hike. And so that is also supportive of the dollar. Also as well, we're supporting the dollar is that China and China's contraction. And so money is flowing in a risk-off environment. Money tends to typically flow into the dollar and out of risk on assets like China and commodity currencies. So China ramps up campaign to boost fragile economy and the currency. And so China intensified efforts to stimulate the economy and support its currency as investor concerns over growth outlook persist. And so you've also got that support in the dollar. So ultimately, if you've been, you know, watching my channel for the last you know, month or so, or a couple of months, I've been saying, you know, my bias is more to go long on the dollar, and you know, that's being justified, of course, with the data, because the data has to support that narrative. But the dollar is best placed, I think, anyway. And so we had prices pull back to that demand zone, and then prices moved to the upside. Although that was a very tricky one to take. Initially, I would have thought it would have probably sold off, but the ISM, you know, the ISM manufacturing did come out and support, in fact, the economy. So that was what boosted the dollar. So I think any pullbacks on the dollar on certain pairs are probably buying opportunities. Looking at the dollar yen, and the dollar yen, I'm actually quite bullish on the yen. Reason being is because the Bank of Japan are more looking towards being the only really bank next year who are possibly looking to hike rates, while everyone else is probably holding or cutting rates. But again, that depends on inflation data and their GDP data. But leading BOJ hawk broaches possibility of early 2024 rate hike, right? So while everyone else, as I said, is holding rates, Bank of Japan potentially could be hiking rates. So it's a case of buying the rumor, right? The rumor is starting, so buy the rumor. But against the dollar, it might not be the best idea, to be fair, because the dollar is probably one of the stronger currencies. But you do have, in fact, technically, this area here and this area here. So this was analysis that was done a couple of weeks ago. Didn't update this chart anyways. But yeah, prices did bounce off of that demand zone on Friday as we made higher highs, higher lows. So you can see prices made high, pulled back, made new highs, and then pulled back to that area. That was a bargain price there. So, you know, we had data that supported, you know, buying there. Now, I do think that prices in the short term could go higher simply because the Bank of Japan at the moment is remaining quite dovish. But the higher it goes, we could see intervention come into the market, which is basically the Bank of Japan actually buying their currency in an attempt to try to stem devaluation, which, you know, will push, end up pushing prices to the downside, or should anyways. You know what I'm saying? It will, because there's no certainties in trading. But ultimately, the levels that you're looking at, if you're looking to short, are going to be this supply zone here, the 14650s, 147s. And if you're looking to buy the dollar, you're probably looking for more of a pullback into this zone here before looking at going long. So that's where, you know, you're looking at the trades. And again, just looking at that from a daily, then going down into maybe an intraday and looking at, you know, your entries, whether you trade the 4 hour, the 2 hour, the 1 hour. You know, I trade custom time frame charts like the 6 and the 8 as well. So so let's see what happens in and around this zone here. I think technically this is really nice because traders are actually caught down here going short, and then all of a sudden they're caught on the wrong side of the market. So that's a setup that we know to be as capture pain relief, where traders are captured in going short. And I think any pullbacks into this zone here, I think are going to be really, really nice for a buy technically. But over the medium to long term, I am more bullish on the yen. Going back to the dollar Swiss. So again, dollar Swiss, my bias would be to go more long on that dollar Swiss. So we are grinding higher. There was a pullback into the into that demand zone earlier in the week on Wednesday, of course, and prices did, you know, move to the upside. So I do think any pullbacks, especially deeper pullback, I think are going to be decent areas to go long. The Swiss franc are, the Swiss National Bank are looking to end their intervention. They've been buying the Swiss franc to appreciate it, and they've reached their 2% target. So I don't think that they're going to continue to appreciate their currency, which should, in fact, devalue their currency. So, but if you do want to be short on the Swiss franc, as far as you want to go long on the Swiss franc and short on the dollar, then you're looking at that supply zone. If you're looking to go long on the dollar, pull back into that zone there is decent. And I think that was like a long term, yeah, it was more of a long term support area, which has actually worked, right? It's been validated. So dollar CAD, the Canadian dollar came out there. I think their GDP came out on Friday with non-farm payrolls, and it wasn't good. So I think they're more in the contraction phase. So yeah, we have really, I think this currency pair is more of a buy than a sell. So any pullbacks, if you do get any, I think down into that zone is going to be nice, as well as down into the 134s for now in the short term. You do have oil you know, going higher, so that could actually add to inflation. But the probabilities and the chances of the Bank of Canada hiking rates this week, I think, when is it now? It's going to be on there's PMIs, and then you've got unemployment rate. So it's not on here, but it's going to be this week. I think it's Wednesday. They're going to look to hold rates, which doesn't support necessarily Canadian dollar at the moment. So if you see any pullbacks, I think are going to be nice buys. That would be where my bias is to trade this currency pair. A New Zealand dollar, US dollar, same thing, buying the US dollar over the New Zealand dollar. The path of this resistance is to the downside. I think all of this you can probably class as some sort of supply, not greatest, but and or the strongest area of supply at the moment. But I do think that that if you are looking to short the this currency pair, you can look for either pullbacks into this zone, or even better yet, into that, you know, 60 cent area right here, the underside of that level, that supply zone, to look for short trades. There's really no reason to buy the New Zealand dollar, so yeah, it's just gonna be for me anyway, shorts all the way on this New Zealand dollar US dollar pair. The pound dollar, so again, the dollar, I think the pound dollar should probably more range, because the pound is expected to hike one more time. And so it says here that cracks in the economy, in the UK economy, will give the Bank of England pause for thought. And so uncomfortably high inflation and wage growth should seal the deal on a September rate hike from the Bank of England. But emerging economic weakness suggests that the top of the tightening cycle is near, and our base case is for a pause in November. So, you know, I think in the short term, you still have the Bank of England hiking rates, and so that should be supportive of the pound in the short term. So I think any pullbacks should be buying opportunities. I'm personally not trading this currency pair. I think there are better pairs to buy the pound against. So if you're looking to buy the pound, the question you got to ask yourself is the dollar the weakest currency out there? And it by far is not. So for me, I would look for another currency pair. But if you are looking to trade this pair, then you have got, in fact, all of this zone is going to be supply. And it's not necessarily pretty, but I would say if you are looking to break down that wide zone, one of the things you can do is look for horizontal support and resistance within these areas. You can even go down into the lower time frames and try and get a bit more detail as to support and resistance within that supply zone. So I think these highs, around these highs, are going to be decent for a to look for some sort of reaction as well around here. And you've also got, I think, somewhere probably around there as well. So that's what you can look towards. But again, for me, I'm not looking to take this pair. I'm looking to buy the pound, but not against the dollar. Euro. So the euro, again, not, you know, there's a lower probability of one more hike. In fact, although the ECB, Wunsch, I think that's how you pronounce it, says a bit more probability needed on rate hikes, the European Central Bank might need to raise rates further before coming to a pause in its hiking cycle, said Governing Council member Pierre Wunsch. You know, he sounds hawkish, but the market doesn't believe him, because Morgan Stanley and several other banks say the ECB rate hikes are over. So the bank previously expected a final rate increase this month. Slowing services inflation, deteriorating economy changes the view, right? Because ultimately, to hike as you're going into a potential recession, or, you know, the contracting phase of the economic cycle, what tends, if you're hiking within that environment, then you may push your economy deeper into a recession. But the issue is, or the problem is, with that, is that their inflation is still too high, and their the bank are mandated to get it down to their 2% target. So they're in a tougher spot over the US economy, right? So, you know, there is stagflation fears basically going on. So when you look at the issues that the US have in comparison to Europe, I think Europe are in a worse place. And this is why you're seeing, you know, these lower highs, lower lows, right? The path for these resistance is to the downside. So you can make, you know, reasons to buy the euro, of course. They are, you know, potentially hiking, but it depends on whether the market believes them. And I think the probability of them hiking now isn't great. I think it's lower than 50-50. So the path of least resistance is to the downside as the euro gets repriced, and, you know, economic fears start to get priced in as well. So really, I think the path of least resistance, as I said, is to the downside. You're looking at pullbacks into supply zones before looking at getting short, I would say. Of course, you can look to buy the euro if there is supportive data. You know, I think this week, what is there? You've got balance of trade, which is correlated with GDP growth. So if you have a good balance of trade, that might be a bit of a boost to the euro. If I'm buying, again, if I'm buying the euro, which I am against, for example, something like the Australian dollar or the Canadian dollar, it wouldn't, I'm not buying it against the US dollar. I think at the moment the US dollar is one of the stronger pairs, so it's not really a pair I'm looking to trade at the moment. But those are your technical options. Euro Swiss, this was a lovely trade, you know, a really nice stop hunt above that level, and I spoke about this in the members area. You know, the euro stop hunt, and we spoke about this in fact in the setup, a potential setup in the group call before it happened. But yeah, so we've got euro yen, looks like the potential for a pullback in here. I think if the euro continues to weaken, whereas the Bank of Japan maybe, you know, intervene or, you know, become a bit more hawkish, then I think this is going to be really, really nice, this setup for a pullback into that zone. We do have some demand here, so we could see in the short term prices pull back, but I think maybe this might be the high for now, as prices have you know, are in this auction. They've been moving, you know, sideways for the past since maybe what, the 9th of August. So pretty much nearly a month now, prices have been going sideways. So let's see what happens here. But if you are looking to buy the euro at the moment, then now is a decent time. If you're looking to buy the yen, then I think any pullbacks into, you know, this area, this supply zone, is going to be decent for a buy trade. Euro pound. I think at the moment my bias would be to go short on this currency pair, where I'm buying the pound. I think the pound are in a better position than Europe, only just, but I say only just, but I think they're in a definitely a better position when it comes to rate hikes. But yeah, I think any pullbacks into these zones, I think, are decent shorting opportunities here and here, if you want to get involved in that. Buying the euro against the pound, I think something would have to really kind of change from a fundamental perspective, and I think for now, out of the two, I think the pound is probably the stronger of the two. Aussie dollar, the Australian dollar, having their rate announcement this week as well. They got GDP growth as well as balance of trade, and that's it. They got the RBA rate decision now. They're expected to hold rates, but also as well, it does depend upon the strength of the Australian dollar, will depend upon how hawkish or dovish the statement is. Also as well, you know, we touched on it, China not doing good is also weighing on the Australian dollar, and really kind of, you know, supportive of the US dollar. So we could see prices, you know, fall to the downside. That'd be the path of this resistance. If price does, you know, start to come up to these areas, I think these are nice shorting opportunities, as long as nothing materially, sentiment or fundamentally changes with, you know, the RBA and the Australian dollar. So yeah, I think those are the areas. If you do want to be a buyer, of course, of the Australian dollar, then you do have this. Let me just put this on here. This is where this demand is. So you can wait for prices to come back into that 83, 84, 83, 80 area and look for some buy trades there. But I do think that, you know, the path of these resistance is still to the downside, as long as risk remains more off and China is still contracting, etc. And then we've got gold. So gold came up to this supply zone. That supply zone didn't hold. The dollar, obviously, you know, being a lot stronger. And we've paused for a little bit, or we reacted at this price point. So again, gold is reacting from maybe like a weaker dollar, or maybe some risk off fears. In fact, yeah, I think about it, in fact, if the dollar was strengthening, gold really shouldn't have been strengthening. So the fact that gold has been going higher indicates that there are probably a lot more fears coming into the market, or that there's probably maybe the market is trying to the gold bugs are maybe trying to price out rate hikes. Either way, if you believe that that gold is a buy based off of, you know, economic fears, recession fears, then really you're looking for a pullback into that zone before getting long. So let me just tidy this up, zoom out a little bit. Yeah, so we did bounce off of this demand zone, and there's demand there, and then there's demand right there. So that's where we are in terms of buying gold. Any pullbacks, if you're looking to short gold, I think this is going to be a really nice technical level to short gold. So if you're looking to still buy the dollar and you think the dollar is going to be strong and appreciate, then in fact this is going to be a nice short. So again, it really just depends on what you think fundamentally. And I think the dollar is coming to an end of its strength. I think in the short term, it probably can continue to go a little bit higher if the data supports it. So I think maybe gold might start to, you know, come to the, you know, move to the downside again if the data supports it, right? So that's where we are. And economic, maybe Chinese economic fears as well have been you know, supportive of gold. If they're on the horizon, there could be some, you know, risk off events. I've read somewhere someone's expecting a bit of a black swan event to happen this year. So let's see what happens. But those are really the options. And so that brings us to the end of this week's fundamental analysis and technical analysis video. Hope you have a great trading week. And also as well, for those of you who are interested in joining, I will be opening up the mentoring group at the first week of October. I haven't decided on a specific date just yet, but as soon as I do, I will announce it in the videos. So again, hope you have a great trading week. Take care and speak to you all soon. For their main export to China. So a challenging path lies ahead for the economy. Both we and the RBNZ are forecasting the economy is in recession starting from Q3. But what remains highly uncertain is how much of the economy must slow to get inflation back to target. We think the RBNZ will eventually need to do more to get on top of inflation, but we are closely watching China's slowdown, which could do the job for it. And let me again, I don't know if I said this last week, but I will reiterate this as again, yeah? Is that not all rate hikes are seen as positive. Not all rate hikes are seen as positive. The reason why is because if you're hiking rates and GDP is coming down, right, or you're already in the contraction phase, you end up, you know, the central bank is basically causing the GDP to go into a deeper contraction, right? Which is, again, a harder hole to dig themselves out of, yeah? And so it's a conundrum that the RBNZ is in, right? So the RBNZ are like, we've got high inflation of, what's their inflation, by the way? Something like maybe 6% or something like that? Is it somewhere around there? Let's say 6%, somewhere around there. And they're already in a recession, right? So what do you do in terms of being a central bank? Obviously, your mandate is to get inflation down. But as you're getting inflation down, you go deeper into a deep recession and a deeper recession and a deeper recession, right? And so inflation comes down, but recession gets deeper. So it's a conundrum that is a very, very tricky one in terms of, you know, what is known as, you know, stagflation. Now, how would the market take that? This is the thing, right? This is the key thing to note, yeah? And again, none of us really know 100%. The market could look at rate hikes and go, well, they're doing a good thing, yeah? In terms of, you know, by hiking rates, we get a bit more of a return. But if they're causing their economy to go into a recession, how positive is that, right? Because you have economies, for example, I don't know, an extreme example would be something like Venezuela, right? Or Argentina, not to pick on, you know, these South American countries, but, you know, it could be African countries, it could be Iraq, right? Where you have interest rates could be somewhere in the region of maybe, you know, 100%, right? You could have 100% interest rate. Yeah, that's brilliant. That's excellent, right? Why doesn't the market flood? Why do you think the market doesn't start putting their money into, you know, 100%, you know, I don't know, Argentinian peso? Why would you think that that is not a thing? There's a couple of reasons, but did anyone want to have a hazard a guess or a couple of guesses as to why you wouldn't, you know, because you can turn the mic on if you want. People still writing? Maybe people are writing. All right, I'll put you out of your misery. No, I was saying, why wouldn't, if you saw a country is offering 100% interest rate, yeah, return on your money, yeah? If interest rates are always positive, if interest rates always, you know, are appreciate a currency 100% of the time, why isn't the market putting their money into really high yielding currencies like the, you know, it could be the Nigerian lira or, you know, the Iraqi whatever they have, right? Why is it? Right. Testing. Right. Well, one of the reasons is that it's the confidence in the currency, right? And so what you'll find is that the economies and the central banks that offer these massive returns, if you look at their economies are nonsense, right? In terms of, you know, business, international trade, right? The reason why they offer such high returns is because they offset that with their economy being so poor and no growth, right? Because you're going to have to invest to hold that currency. You're going to have to invest. It's like investing in the country, right? You're investing by holding that currency. You're investing in the country. That's basically what it turns down to, right? And so even though you might get 100%, who in their right mind is going to, you know, invest in that country? If they're in some deep depression, there's no business, why would you? Do you know what I mean? It's a high risk. Also as well, those countries are at higher risk of defaulting, yeah? In terms of, like, you know, when we talk about the US being a safe haven currency, it's because they have a very, probably the highest in the world, right? Probability of not defaulting on their debt, regardless of what the doom and gloomers say out there. I know, you know, there's the Max Kaisers of the world and, you know, the Manorinos of the world, right? These guys will try to convince you, and hundreds and thousands of other pundits that will tell you that, you know, the dollar's going to collapse and the dollar's going to collapse, da 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 da. No, it's not, right? I can't say it's not, because anything can happen, right? The only thing in life that is certain is death, not even taxes, because, you know, if you read the Panama Papers, there are people out there, entities out there that are avoiding tax. So the only certainty in life is death, right? But the point being is that the you know, the West, the G10, right? These countries are less likely, the least likely to default on paying their debt. And I get it, they have massive, yeah, Ken says, is it though? But it's true, it's the truth, right? And you might get downgrades. Oh, one second, I'll mute you. Welcome, Frank. I'll mute you as well. But that, because you think about, for example, the S&P, right? S&P 500. You think about the stock market, the US stock market, right? What stock market in the world is better than the US? Right, in terms of, you know, the amount of money that they generate, the output, the companies. Europe? No. Right, the FTSE 100? Nope. The what You know what I mean? But so when you look at the stock market, a stock market is representative of a country's economy sometimes, right? Well, a lot of times it's reflected, but not necessarily always in price, yeah? But even emerging markets, right? If you're looking at, all right, what companies outside are bigger than like Tesla, Apple, do you know what I mean? Amazon, Facebook, there you go, US for sure, right? So regardless of how bad the US is doing from a debt perspective, they're still producing, right? And so the thinking is that they're least likely to default on their debt, yeah? Because they're always gonna produce. They're always gonna produce, regardless of whether they go into a recession, even a bust or slump phase, they'll still be able to pay their debts, yeah? Well, I can't say always, but they're the most likely country to not default on their debt. They'll find a way, yeah? Whereas, going back to this 100% interest rate, you know, these countries here, right, the rest of the world, yeah, you might get 100%, but these countries are more likely to default on their debt because of their economies, yeah? Their economies are not competing with the West, yeah, with these massive, you know, with Japan, with Switzerland, etc., with Europe, right? And so it's not always a case of interest rates good, because this example will tell you that higher interest rates don't always mean, you know, an appreciating currency. So when going back to the New Zealand dollar, yeah, the New Zealand dollar, you know, the market may think, okay, even though you're hiking rates, you're putting pressure on companies in a recession investment. Why would I then invest in a country, yeah, that is going into a recession and in fact interest rates are causing a deeper recession? Why would I in fact hold New Zealand dollars if companies are going out of business? Why would I? Ego says dollar is king, yeah, right? But again, that's the question. Why would I do that? Yeah, why would I do that as an international investor? Yeah, I can get 5% on my money, cool. But I'm not gonna invest if these big companies are going out of business. So hiking rates isn't always positive. It's not always positive. And so if they're in a recession, yeah, if a country's in a recession, it doesn't mean that, yeah, I'm still going to go and buy that currency because the central bank are hiking rates. So, sorry about it being long-winded, but does everyone understand that? Does everyone understand, or does anyone not understand that?